We have a quorum to convene our security panel meeting. So first of all, agenda item number one, since the last meeting, we have some information papers that have been issued, and Mr. Yip Kin has written me a letter and I have passed it on to the relevant department. Second item, Mr. Yip Kin, thank you for mentioning my letter. This might be our last meeting, so how will you handle my letter? The water cannons were deployed on 1st of July. It was very unreasonable. Reporters and members of the public were attacked, and that needs to be dealt with. Well, typically, we will forward the letter to the government departments, and we'll also forward it to our members. So that means during recess, they will still receive our letter. Yes. Now, please take note regarding today's meeting time. You are aware that at 4:30, we have a joint panel meeting with the three panels. So we would like to conclude at 4:20 because I need to reserve time for our secretariat to prepare for the next meeting. No objections. Then agenda item number two, Mr. Kenneth Leung has a private member bill regarding the Public Inquiry 2019 Public Order Bill. So all members have been invited to discuss this issue. So I'll have Mr. Leung, let me finish. I'll have Mr. Leung to take us through the paper and members can raise questions. Mr. Siukajun. I note that Mr. Kenneth Leung's bill is called the Public Inquiry 2019 Public Order Bill, but agenda item number two has labeled it as Public Inquiry 2019 Riots Bill. Now, is there a typo, or could you give us an explanation why it was labeled as such? Well, you have to ask Mr. Leung. Mr. Leung had forwarded the information to the Secretariat, and then he made an amendment. So it is not a fault with the Secretariat. So let us move into this agenda item and invite the government officials. So if you have questions, you have to press a button. Mr. Leung, you can start. Thank you, Chairman. This bill on 24th of September last year had been submitted to this panel. So I worked on this bill with some Hong Kong youth scholars. So the name of the bill should be Public Inquiry 2019 Public Order Bill. So the text is from last year. So that is the name of the bill. The bill on 12th of February this year had received a confirmation from the law draftsman that it is in compliance with the format of Hong Kong laws. There were a few reasons for proposing this bill. First of all, in the mutual aid bill that we raised last year, what problems did the government encounter? And second, between June and October 2019, in the public order issues, riots or gatherings, the different stakeholders, including the protesters, the police, the public, there were some confrontations, and these include but are not limited to inciting hatred or taking excessive force and so on. Third, this bill also proposes that the EXCO when they deal with controversial laws, they need to take steps. So that is one of our aims. And fourth, this panel can, under peaceful circumstances, can we have some improvements to police work? And we also want to have a consensus among society for regarding mediation. So this bill is based on existing Hong Kong laws. We're using it as a blueprint. We're deploying the terms of reference, the membership, and so on. It is based on this investigation committee. So the only major difference is in page 3, the last paragraph. In the bill, I have proposed that any person, when they give a witness to the commission, the evidence that is given and so on, so whether it is, whether they mention a third party, so the evidence given in the commission cannot be used in other civil or criminal proceedings. So I have made such an amendment because whether you are a participant in a social event, whether you're a journalist, a medical personnel, or a policeman, you can give evidence and need not worry that the third parties mentioned in your evidence might be prosecuted. Now, Chairman, I am aware this is the last meeting of the security panel, and I hope that if in October, when our members return, if they feel this work is worthy of continuation, I welcome you to use this open source. You can use this bill to follow up. Thank you, Chairman. I see two members have indicated they wish to speak. Anybody else? So 4 minutes, including Q&A. Mr. Yevgeny and then Lok Chung Hong. Chairman, I'm aware Mr. Kenneth Leung had submitted this document last September, but unfortunately it's now July when we have an opportunity to address it. Now, this issue, why did the extradition bill drag on so long? Aside from the government ignoring public views, and when we had social events and that broke out, and the government only withdrew the bill in last September, we had police abusing their powers, that is violence and arrests, plus 21st of July when the attackers dressed in white attacked passengers in a subway station. So that led to significant social unease. So what we're doing now is totally wrong. We're adopting national security laws to deal with social unrest. So national security laws came about because we ignored the issue. Now, if we look at the roots of the issue, then I think we won't be in today's situation. The whole issue in the extradition bill, we had called for an independent investigation. So if the independent investigation was conducted, then I don't think we would have arrived at this stage. But the government did not address the issue. We allowed police to abuse their powers and arrest people, and now we are introducing draconian laws, but that will not reduce public lack of confidence and anger. So I think Mr. Kenneth Leung's bill is very valuable. If we can endorse it, that would be very good. But unfortunately, we're in July right now. So even today, if we can support the bill, nothing will come out of it. So come October, when the new legislature convenes, I hope there will be support for investigation, and I hope Mr. Kenneth Leung's work could be taken up by himself or other members. And I feel that if the government wishes to solve problems, then if they could conduct an independent investigation, it could help with some preliminary resolution of our difficulties. But the current situation is indeed very concerning. Let's see if the government wishes to respond. Mr. Leung, I think my response would be, I would like to have more members in our legislature call for independent investigation, because when a policeman deals with a political issue, you can see that is not the ideal solution. We had called for 5 demands, and now there are calls for Hong Kong independence and so on. Is that what we want to see? If the one of the 5 demands, if that is a call for independent investigation, there are many elements to it. If there was a resolution or improvements, but nothing was done, and that we end up with what we have today. We have a high-handed rule.
Mr. Lok Chun Hong, now from the extradition bill, or as an excuse to trigger off what we saw, the black terrorism of last year. Now, this is something plain for all to see. This is, destroying the rule of law and destroying the peaceful expression of political views. So this good tradition is broken, and the one country, two system basis is being threatened. Now, of course, if you look back in history, people would come to an interpretation. Now, of course, we are witnessing tensions here, but who is challenging this sort of tension, especially people's livelihood? Or some people deliberately stimulate people's sentiments to let this fire grow beyond control, especially after the 15th of October. The extradition bill was already suspended. How come we still see illegal activities escalating? Now, I really like to know, can I ask Mr. Leung? Now, you said at the beginning that you want to check the issue facing the government. Now, it takes two to tango. We have people who are rioters, but what are the reasons behind their actions? Media has reported from Oslo. They have admitted rioters and protesters to be trained, and this is reported by the BBC. So we are looking at endless resources being thrown in to the rioters in the forms of helmet and coupons and other resources given to these rioters, amounting to the tune of hundreds of millions of dollars. And you have NED from the US sponsoring such activities. Now, how is the money spent, and who pockets those money? And how many politicians went abroad to seek sanctions against certain Hong Kong people? Now, and of course, the Sino-US trade war is a point of issue. And have these politicians accepted views from overseas countries to create trouble for Hong Kong? Now, we see a lot of irresponsible promotion, fake news. You have the 31st of August, how many people have died, and they were buried somewhere. So all these news were reported. And of course, there's another one, the mother appearing on the 21st of July. And also the June 13th incident, the explosion. How was the eye hurt? And how about that person disappeared? So a lot of these suspicious cases. And also there are government-subvented NGOs providing venues for the terrorists to store their resources and equipment. Okay, now time is up, but Mr. Leung, please keep a brief reply. Now, I have listed the 6 points already. Now, the inquiry is to attempt to come to some sort of a resolution or reconciliation. Now, I welcome Mr. Lok to provide evidence to this inquiry committee, and you have to come up with evidence. So I welcome that. Now, can I just ask Mr. Au, the Undersecretary, please? Now, the SARG does not support the proposed members' bill entitled Public Inquiry Disturbances Bill. Now, this will challenge Article 74 of the Basic Law. And this will also have an impact on the finances of the SARG. Now, Article 74 says that the electrical member of the SARG, now following private members' bill, if it doesn't involve finance or politics, can be raised by individual or joint members. And if it involves government policies, it should have a written agreement from the CE. So according to Article 74, electrical members cannot raise anything which concerns finances or political structure unless you have the written agreement of the CE. So our response is, number one, on the mechanism of the Hong Kong government and the finances, they are all determined by the government. And if a members' bill would lead to an increase or decrease of the government finances, or a significant amount is involved, then that members' bill will be seen to involve a public expenditure. Now, on government mechanism or operation, now if the inquiry involves that, it will have to involve setting up of a secretariat to help the inquiry committee to listen to evidence. And this again would entail public expenditure. It would involve paying the chairman, the committee members, the secretariat staff, as well as barristers and their fees. Now, if you look at the Sha Tin Central project inquiry as an example, the government, now in May this year, has replied to a media that the expenses were something like $92 million. And the whole inquiry board would have to be, their expenditure would have to be decided later. So all in all, Article 74 would have to be invoked and this disallows members' private bill. Now, secondly, on the government's policy, now, Cap 86 of the Laws of Hong Kong empowers the CE and the CE in Council to have a board of inquiry to look into public officials' performance as well as issues of public interest. And this inquiry board or committee is similar to what Mr. Leung is proposing. So what Mr. Leung proposes overlaps with what is already in the laws of Hong Kong, and so is unnecessary. Now, thirdly, now the inquiry proposes certain issues of investigation item. In fact, some of these have already been dealt with by the Independent Police Commission. And since June last year, you have public events and other macro issues. They have already been dealt with, including independent scrutiny of the police. And based on Chapter 81C, 52 recommendations have been made, and amounting to more than 1,000 pages of report, including the 6 specified issues and 2 issues of public concern. Now, to establish the facts and so on, then the Independent Police Council has already spent a lot of money on this, and the IPCC has already ascertained and double-check to make sure that the report is reliable. Now, the CE also asked the Secretary for Security to set up a committee to look into the matter. In other words, to follow up on the report and to liaise with the relevant departments. And on the 28th of May, this committee has already met for the first time, and it will regularly report to the CE. And the initial plan is to have a progress report to the CE in August, followed by regular quarterly reports, and also to report to the IPCC regularly. Now, based on all these work already done, the SARG does not support Mr. Leung's private member's bill to be scrutinized by LegCo. Okay, I think we have to draw a line here. And you've also answered some member's bill. I'm afraid I don't have more time for you to continue. We have to move on to the next item, drug situation in Hong Kong in 2019. And we have Ms. Ivy Law, Mr. Kevin Lai Ming Fai, and Dr. Billy Lee. Now, if members wish to ask questions, please press the button. And I would first of all ask the government officials to brief members. Now, we now have 11 members wanting to ask questions. So 3 minutes each, including Q&A. I'm waiting for the commissioner to be seated. And so, Ms. Law, do you want to introduce the paper to us? Now, can I urge members here, if you want to ask questions, please press the button now. Otherwise, I will draw a line here. Now, we have Lam Cheuk-ting, Chen Chong-ying, Yu Siu-wing, Tong Li-jie, Pun Siu Ping, Kenneth Leung, Yong Ho Yan, Xiu Ka Chun, Dr. Fernando Cheng, Elizabeth Kwat, and Chen Chi Chun. 3 minutes. Commissioner, now today we're going to report to you the drug situation in Hong Kong, including statistics, the trend, and the latest situation. Now on numbers, now in 2019, we have more than 5,000 such cases, with 17% reduction than 2018. But those under 21, we have 1% increase. And for the age group, 21 to 35, it accounts for 46%, a rather high percentage. Now, the types of drugs, heroin is the number one drug, and followed by ice. These are the psychotropic drugs. Now, since we have overall decrease, but there's an increase of cannabis consumption. Now, on age profile, most of them have taken drugs for more than 5.5 years, and they stay home most of the time, and not easy to be detected. Now on the trend, now we see that overall it is under control, but we have to be careful. Youngsters, we see an increase in young abusers. Those between 21 and 35, at 46%, that's pretty high. And then cannabis users, pretty high, especially among the young people. And then we also have some sort of hidden drug abuse is still a concern. Now, because of this trend, we're going to have a multi-pronged approach, education, promotion, rehabilitation, law enforcement, external cooperation, and research.
We will continue our PENP, that is preventive education and publicity. Last year, we strengthened our efforts in dealing with cannabis. We have education targeting young people and their misconceptions regarding cannabis. We also help their parents to identify cannabis use in rehabilitation, in treatment and rehabilitation. We are extending our services. The Beat Drugs Fund will be coordinating its efforts. We also have legislation, law enforcement, and external cooperation strategies. We will regulate dangerous drugs. We will target the source. And Chairman, that would conclude my report, and we welcome any questions. First, Mr. LAM Cheuk-ting. How 3 minutes with Q&A? Let's start. Chairman, regarding Hong Kong sale and trafficking of drugs, it is a major concern, especially when police participate in trafficking and consumption of drugs. Recently in West Kowloon, there was a drug bus, and they had busted the largest trafficking case, where we had more than 100 million worth of drugs being trafficked. They were able to steal 20 kilos of drugs, and the police sergeant was able to steal it, even under the eyes of 20-30 officers. Some 60 pounds worth of drugs were stolen. The police also claim that they have a program where officers have to take drug tests, and the 7 senior police officials will lead by example and take drug testing. In the past, we had policemen arrested because of concealing drugs, trafficking drugs. So I want to ask our commissioner, is she aware of drug use in the police force? Is she aware that there are cases of trafficking involving the police, and that what is your stance and position? Will you educate the police to stop them from consuming and trafficking in drugs. Well, thank you, Chairman. Thank you. I need to clarify the information. The police officers that were arrested, they are a minority. And the police force has also clarified that for any police officer who, there is zero tolerance. So the description that you gave just now does not exist. Well, if drug use is not severe amongst the police force, then why will the senior management lead by example and take drug testing? Why do they require officers in sensitive positions to take undergo testing? Because they would not require people to take drug tests for no reason. We don't see the Electrical Secretariat asking its colleagues to take drug test to undergo drug testing. We are doing preventative education, so voluntary drug testing is part of our preventive education. Well, the Commission for Narcotics, will you ask your colleagues to do the drug testing? Well, in the schools, we have healthy schools. We also encourage high school students to do drug testing. It is a pledge to stay away from drugs. So you are concerned that the police officers are in close proximity to drugs and you're afraid that they would take drugs. I did not say that. Mr. Tan Ying, I am worried about cannabis use. In the paper, we see that in 2019, there has been an increase, and the commissioner also mentioned that there was a 48% of cannabis uses under 21 years of age. And we see that there are some popular destinations for students, such as Canada, where they have legalized cannabis. So when the students return to Hong Kong, the laws are different. They need to be reminded of the laws. So perhaps the Commission for Narcotics or the police, what have they done for what education programs have they done for our students studying abroad? Now, there has been an API recently, and I don't see the negative aspects of cannabis use. They only seem to be, they have only made a video targeting young people. So we have different cannabis products. There's food, there are beverages, topical creams, and hair creams, and so on. So I would like to ask the commissioner, do you have any statistics where Hong Kong has imported these products for sale, and the public, have they consumed or used these cannabis products inadvertently? Thank you. Regarding Canada, a recreational use cannabis being legalized, I'd like to clarify that according to Canadian law, they do not allow cannabis products to be exported, and we have worked with the Trade Commission of Canada. So Hong Kong students studying in Canada or Hong Kong residents staying in Canada, they have to understand that Canadian laws don't allow export of these products, and Hong Kong does not allow the importation of cannabis products. And in this respect, we have some cooperation with them. So for students studying abroad, we have courses. Well, when they enroll in exchange programs, we tell them to not import or export drugs. Now, your second question was about API regarding cannabis, an announcement of public interest, and we have feedback from our colleagues where they tell us that young people dislike to be preached at. So we are taking a positive approach, and If they want a healthy lifestyle, they should avoid cannabis. And in June, we have published some pamphlets and detailed information regarding the harmful effects of cannabis. We want to target the young people and clear up any misconceptions. So this agenda item will run to 3:40, and we now have 9 members who wish to speak, so I'll have to draw the line here. Mr. Yu Siwen. So we see the statistics, the drug users have gone down by 17%, but we saw an increase in cannabis users. You raised the issue about Canada, and tourists might have brought products into Hong Kong. So do we have any statistics on this? Or is it just local drug users that led to this increase? Second, I see the drug users under 21 years, the number has not gone down. In fact, it went up by 1%. And the number of students, they made up 20% in 2018. And it went up to 26% in 2019. So we have more students taking cannabis. And I saw last year we had social events in the second half of the year. A lot of students gather together. So when we have a lot of students congregating, is there peer pressure? And that leads to more drug use. Have we compared the first half of the year and second half of the year? If the figures went up in the second half of the year, what can the government do to halt the increase of student drug users? Regarding cannabis, it is alarming, especially amongst young people. There has been a significant increase of cannabis users. So we are working with schools, parents, and on the internet because these are the major conduits where young people receive information regarding cannabis. We have a web platform, and our Beat Drugs Fund also produces material and provides assistance to students who are using cannabis, help them we also see that young people are taking drugs at home, so parents need to understand if their children are taking drugs, if they can identify drug use, they can intervene at an early stage. One of our important partners are schools. So the commission works with schools, and we educate the children with the help of schools. Well, the commissioner did not answer my question regarding tourists. And starting from second half of last year, has drug use increased in the second half? Well, you can provide information after the meeting. Mr. Tony Chair, just now Mr. Yu reported on the statistics that we have less drug users, and even though different age groups or different drugs have different usage levels, but overall the figures have come down. Previously, the government had admitted. Why did the numbers go down? It's not a real decrease, it's just that as of last year, while dealing with social violence, police resources were worn thin. So do the statistics really reflect reality? So perhaps the commissioner might have some views on this, because if police resources are spread thin, and we don't have an accurate assessment of the drug situation, then that is not ideal. We need to do a better job, especially in recent months. News has reported the drug seizures, the street value is very high. Is it because police resources were stretched too thin and drug traffickers have been have had they have had a free hand in trafficking? So what is the situation? Has it improved or has it deteriorated? So I'm not sure if the commissioner or do government officials have any response. Thank you, Chairman. Regarding the central registry, our intelligence officers provide the information, and it's not limited to the law enforcement agencies. We have hospitals, schools, and rehabilitation centers providing information. So they were not affected by the social incidents. Now, your reference to social incidents, we had more arrests and police resources were spread thin. So resources were tight in that area. The government is aware of this. And we have mentioned that in the paper. We have to be careful when we look at arrests, because in 2019 compared to 2018, there has been a significant drop, and that is because the resources were worn thin.
Let me continue, Chair. Now, drug rehabilitation is a really serious social issue. We want to spend more resources on this. Now, we have a seed fund of $33 million, so we do have enough funding to do this worthwhile task. Pun Xiuping, Chair. Yes, like other members, I am very much concerned about young people taking cannabis. We see an increase of 48%. Now, some have asked about undergraduates and where did they get the product and where were those products sold. Now, the paper said in paragraph 17 that in future you will build upon the ongoing initiatives as well as explore new approaches and channels to appeal to members of the public, especially young people. Now, I'd like to know more about these new initiatives. Have you started them already? So what are the new approaches? Now, secondly, on the fund for drug prevention, now you use, well, something like 160 million or 16 billion. Now, and you are going to have some sort of future plan. Now, the future funding, what is it going to be like, and how many will apply for such a fund? Now, thank you for your question. Now, on paragraph 17, the ongoing initiatives and the new approaches. Now, we're going to do promotion to use a more down-to-earth channel through the web or web celebrities in order to effectively disseminate the information. Now, we're also using new technology. Now, for example, we can have virtual reality scenes for young members to look at so that they know about the bad consequences physically and mentally. Now, on the drug prevention fund, now we will establish priorities so that the applicants can focus on certain projects. Now, in the past, some focus on cannabis or other follow-up actions. So every year, we consult the ACAN, the ACAN, and then they will scrutinize the various applications for funding. Mr. Kenneth Leung, please. Now, the paper listed different types of drugs, hard and soft. So there is a general decline overall. Now, my concern is drug abuse, either prescribed drugs or OTC drugs that you can get from drugstores. Now, there are some young people using prescribed drugs or OTC drugs, over-the-counter drugs, and mix it with alcohol, because when mixed together, they would reach a certain physical state which they appear to enjoy. Now, this paper appears to be silent on this situation. Now, is it serious? Now, according to doctors, if you do this sort of mixing to abuse drugs, the impact or the damage to the body is comparable to other drugs. But it seems that the government is not doing very much or paying a lot of attention on this scenario. Chair, now on dangerous drugs, we have DDO, dangerous drugs, ordinance, and these will include the drugs that Mr. Leung mentioned. So they would be governed by a relevant pharmaceutical legislation. Now, cough mixture or cough syrup was for a time abused by young people. Now, cough mixtures are usually over-the-counter available, but if it's more toxic, you have to go to registered pharmacies, or if one level up, it becomes a dangerous drug and it's not going to be sold easily. It will come under dangerous drugs. Now, I think Mr. Leung is talking about over-the-counter drugs. Now, the health department, the police and immigration department will raid such pharmacies in 2019. These raids amounted to 9,600 times, and there were 7,000 plus attempts to buy, and 34 resulted in court punishments. So 34 were punished. So is this a very low level, or is it a prosecution number? Now, in 2019, the health department raided 9,600 times and tried to buy 7,500 times, and 34 cases were convicted. Now it's my turn. Now the trend appears to be young people increasing, even though the overall situation is declining. Now, how many young people have been arrested and convicted and sent to rehabilitation home and then come back again to be a repeat offender? Now, I think the number is significant. Now, some have gone through rehabilitation and there's a good chance they would go back in again because they say they have been there more than a year and they mix with the so-called friends, and when coming out, they will be tempted to take drugs again. Now, for the parole officers, have you actually worked with them so that those who have been arrested and when they come out, they would not be repeat offenders? So this is my question. Now, repeat offenders is a really a tough issue. Okay, he or she has been rehabilitated, but because of personal reasons or because of his or her surroundings. So this rehabilitation is really a long climb up a steep hill. Now, apart from your suggestion of a forced rehabilitation, some are voluntary, and there are social rehabilitation measures available. Now, once the addiction is gone, what next? Would there be family support? Will he or she find a job? And for the psychotropic drugs, now, very often these drugs cause permanent damage. For example, affecting hand-eye coordination, affecting brain functions, so they have difficulty finding jobs. Now, we provide some sort of therapy, different types of therapy, occupational therapies and so on, to help them find a job, and we also help their family members. So for these follow-up work, is something that we attach a lot of importance to. Now, we have some sort of a three-year plan, and we do consultation, and one direction is to provide such ex-addicts for follow-up work. Now, if they are released, they may not repeat the practice again. Now, have you done any kind of random sampling, checking their urine samples, and then to extend the parole period? Now, the judge or the court will decide whether it's going to be 1 year or three. And of course, depending on the individual case, to check the urine sample to see whether he or she has taken drugs again or other conditions have been fulfilled. Now, earlier on, I think last Friday, the Correctional Service Department has used the concept of mindfulness to ask the addicts to reduce the chance of taking drugs again. Mr. Xiu Ka-chun, Chair, I think there are myths surrounding drug taking. Now, the social activity may not lead to drug taking. Just as police congregating will not lead to drug taking. Maybe stress is one factor. Mental stress. Maybe this includes a sense of despair. Maybe this sense of despair is even worse than taking drugs. Now, as a social worker, I'd like to ask you three questions. Now, you ask about a three-year plan for rehabilitation. You have done consultation 9 times. Now, when will this three-year plan be expanded to some sort of a prevention and rehabilitation scheme? Now, what I mean is, now, in overseas countries, you look at it wholesale. In Australia, for example, you have a 10-year plan. But now in Hong Kong, you divide up prevention and rehabilitation in the 3-year plan. Now, but what about the 9 items? You're only dealing with just one item. There should be 9. The 3-year plan should be comprehensive. You cannot just pick out or take out the prevention part. Now, on the files, they are all loan cases. And now, first-time reporters, now from 4.9 years to 5.5 years. So this is a very important increase in the length of addiction. So this is hidden drug use is very important. So I ask you for your most updated information. How do you deal with hidden drug abuse? Third, on students taking drugs. Now on 14 to 15 and 17 to 18, figures very clear. There's an increase in the number of students taking drugs. But how come the paper is silent on this year's situation on students taking drugs? Now, if you cannot answer all of them, please give me a written reply. Now, on our rehabilitation 3-year plan, because the scene is changing. Now, 3 years ago, the cannabis users was much lower. So we have to be up to date. So we can respond to the latest situation. Second, on the file information, now, as I said, now for hidden drug abuse, we want to be in touch with young people as well as the drug users, including schools, teachers, parents, and so on. Now, for students, yes, 2 years ago, we had those student numbers. Now, how come we're silent this year? Because we will do another survey, a 3-year study, and then we will provide the latest figures for members.
And we will submit the figures in one go for your reference. So will you provide a written response for the third question? That is, it was answered. They will do a study in 2020-21. Mr. Fernando Chung? Now, even though we have less drug users, but we suspect, does that really reflect the reality? We have the first reported age, there's 5.5 years, from 4.9 has gone up to 5.5. So the first time you discover drug users, they have already been using for 5+ years. So when this number goes up, that means we have a lot of hidden drug users. So do these figures really reflect reality? A lot of people might not be using drugs in public places. If they do it discreetly. So your prevention work, is it really effective? So the government needs to examine its 3-year plan regarding prevention, because you don't even in the title, you don't have include the word prevention. I'm also concerned that police in April and May, there were major incidents. One, a very serious case where a officer had stolen 25 kilos worth of drugs, and they were also involved in a large case, a large bust, where 12 nylon bags, and each bag contained 25 kilos of ice, and it was worth 150 million on the street. So why were they able to traffic it so quickly? And the buyer must have been a triad. It wasn't a retail sale. So that indicates that police triad collusion is very rampant. And we also had a case where a female was able to receive 3 kilos of drugs in a police dormitory. The magistrate the DOJ had had an independent decision on whether to prosecute or not, and the magistrate could not influence that decision. So we see that triad and police collusion is rampant. There should be independent investigation. Do you want the commissioner to respond to your first two questions? I also want to take the opportunity to respond. I want to repeat that the arrested officer, very few of them are related to drug cases, and the police has a zero tolerance policy. The police have also set up a group to monitor the police conduct and also strengthen training. Regarding the archive information, in paragraph 3, we state very clearly that the statistics are based on voluntary information. It reflects drug use as a trend, and we do see that the reported drug use figures are coming down. It indicates that the government and other organizations have had success in their efforts, but we do see drug use amongst young people and cannabis use is going up, so we want to nip it in the bud. Miss Elizabeth Quat, I'm a little worried that the statistics being quoted, that is a downward trend. Is it because we have more hidden drug users? And in fact, that is not the case. If you look at the statistics, the average drug taking years is 5.5 years. They have on average taken drugs for 5.5 years before they are discovered. So the situation might not be as rosy as the government describes. We see especially young drug users and cannabis use is going up. Cannabis use went up 48%. That's a serious problem. As other legislators said, when some countries legalize cannabis, and we do have a lot of students studying abroad, they might bring these habits back to Hong Kong. It affects their peers. So aside from returning students, we also have local users. So we know that cocaine and ice were the popular drugs, and now cannabis is the party drug. So whenever there people gather, they will take cannabis. So a DAB has conducted some surveys recently, and 90%+ of parents object to cannabis use. They are worried their children might get into contact with cannabis, but their children are subject to peer pressure, and parents don't have access to this information. They don't know whether their children are taking drugs. So government education APIs, they feel it's insufficient and they want the government to do more. We heard the government say that they will use new media and different channels to contact young people. It seems that a lot of young people in Hong Kong are not aware of the negative aspects of cannabis. In the past, we had talked about ice and its negative effects on the human body. But what about the harmful effects of cannabis? It seems that education in this aspect is insufficient. We agree we need to strengthen education on negative aspects of cannabis. In fact, we've done a lot of work regarding parents. We have magazines, internet platforms, and even with TV programs, we help parents identify whether their children are taking drugs. So we also have workshops, family camps organized by the Beat Drugs Fund. They have spent $16 million to help parents identify whether their children are taking cannabis. Of course, we will continue these efforts. Mr. Tan Qixun. Thank you, Chairman. I want to follow up on the Fan Bingbing case. When we talk about trafficking ICE, the commissioner says that it's only a small number of police officers and the police has a zero tolerance. Well, that's useless. When these things occur, the public finds it incredulous. And is it just the tip of the iceberg? So aside from trafficking, have they been consuming it themselves? Have they been handing it out as gifts? I know that Commissioner has no access to police information. Aside from trafficking, drug use is also a problem. We have a lot of high risk jobs. So pilots and even bus drivers, they have to take drug tests. Now police are facing the public, they have access to weapons. If they have a drug habit or a dependency on drug or medical drugs, that is very dangerous. So the public have questioned, why are police so violent? Are they on medical drugs? So I want to ask the commissioner, would you agree that the disciplined forces should have a drug testing program? When they enroll, they need to be tested for drugs, and should they be tested regularly? We've had many different commissioners. You've only taken up the post at the end of last year. In the past, we had controversial drug testing in schools and so on. Now, your paper doesn't talk about drug testing anymore. Is it because you feel that it's not feasible? Thank you, Chairman. First of all, Mr. Chan, those were just his speculation. That was his own speculation. We have to look at the statistics. Do we have cases? So, in fact, the number of trafficking or drug use in police, we don't have a lot of cases. So that is a statistic that I want to clarify. Now, regarding the police operations, they will introduce drug testing, and they are now arranging for new recruits, or when they are posted to a sensitive post, they have drug testing, and they will extend that to transfers to sensitive posts. So community drug testing, is that in 2013, ARCAN had conducted a public consultation, and if there were strong environmental factors, there was a reasonable suspicion that a person had taken drugs, they should have drug testing and receive rehabilitation support. Now, the scheme would have involved on personal rights and complex matters. The government does not have a timetable for further consultation. Mr. Wu Jiwai, Mr. Ma Fengguo, you'll have to ask on the next occasion. Mr. Wu Jiwai is the last. I want to follow up on the Fan Bingbing case. We've already talked about officers who broke the law. So I want to follow up on a resident in a police dormitory where they were allegedly involved in 3 kilos of ICE trafficking. The magistrate felt that there should be a trial and felt that it was probably that a sentence would be passed, but the DOJ insisted on not prosecuting, and that led to quite a negative impression in amongst the public. So it seems that some people living in certain areas, even if the magistrate feels that there is an obvious condition for conviction, the DOJ insisted on withdrawing prosecution. So, Commissioner, you repeatedly say that ACAN is doing a lot of education work and the police have zero tolerance, but the public have a negative impression that some people have special privileges. So I want to ask the commissioner, when we encounter such a case, what is your position? How can we restore the public's confidence? That is, we have such an obvious case involving 3 kilos of ICE, and we have a prima facie case, and the magistrate feels that they can be convicted, but the DOJ can insist on withdrawing prosecution. How can you revert the public's impression? That is, this case is not a cover-up, it's not the DOJ colluding with police.
How can you avoid this impression to the public? Because this is going to affect your work. And how do you try to turn things around? Okay, now thank you for your question. Now, on drug trafficking, we adopt a really serious follow-up action. And for any drug trafficking, this will entail heavy penalties on a life in prison. Yes, I know, but what about this particular case? Now, the DOJ has responded, but what about public conception, public impression? It's very negative. Can you turn it around? Now, is it based on a misunderstanding? Well, what is the misunderstanding? Now, the DOJ has already said that they would he or she will follow the book. So you're not trying to improve public image. Now, I would not add further comments on this individual case. I only say that this is zero tolerance, but we're talking about 3 kg of ketamine. Now, maybe Mr. Wu can approach the issue through other channels, because time is up. Now we have to move on to the next item, proposed introduction of offenses on voyeurism and non-consensual photography of intimate parts and related offenses. Now let me just invite the government officials to come in. Now you already have the papers 1286 19-2004. Now there will be a 3-year or 3-month public consultation. after the discussion of this item today. Now, if members want to ask questions, please press the button. Now, we will stop the meeting at 4:20. Now, we have 6 members wanting to ask questions. Now, I don't know, there will be more members, but let's start with 3 minutes. But then we have the Undersecretary for Security, Mr. Sunny Ao, the PS for Security, Mr. Billy Wu, and Ms. Anna Zhang, Chief Superintendent of Police, and Mr. Frank Law, Chief Superintendent of Police, Cyber Security and Technology. Now, under existing legislation, we do not have anything on voyeurism or intimate prying on or any upskirt of photography. We do not have such offense. Now, instead, we will be resorting to loitering under Section 160 or disorder in public places or outraging public decency. Now, some are rather light offenses and cannot really reflect the severity of the case and would not cover offenses in private premises. Now, the CFA in 2019 April regarding obtaining access to a computer with a view to dishonest gain for himself or another, and does not extend to the use of the offender's own computer. In other words, Section 161, bracket 1, bracket C of the Crimes Ordinance does not apply. So, if it is the use of the offender's own computer, the prosecution cannot resort to this 161 section for prosecution. Now, on the release of images, the existing ordinance only involve the promotion of such items and is not particularly suitable for a private sending of such messages among several people. So such distribution of intimate images will not be tackled. So we feel that we need to review the legislation. Now, the LRC appointed a review last year on an issued report on voyeurism and non-consensual upskirt photography. So this has taken a reference from other countries and has provided special penalties for such voyeurism and non-consensual upskirt photography. Now, the government accepted the RRC's report. So, non-consensual intimate pictures will also be guilty of an offense. And in addition, we will also have a corresponding offense for intimate prying, regardless of the purpose. So we also propose that the distribution of photos or videos generated by X in the above four situation is also a criminal offense. And there should also be defenses produced. And all these will be included under the list or the scheme. Now, we are going to have a 3-month consultation period, and then we'll report to the security panel regarding the views that we collected, and then to propose our way forward with the aim to offer this bill to LegCo ASAP. We have seven members, and 3 minutes, starting with Mr. Chen Chi-chun. Thank you, Chair. Now, 3 minutes is really short. Now, I hope you will be paying attention, Mr. Sonny Ao and Mr. Billy Wu. Now, some naked photo of masturbation was taken, and then further such acts were threatened. Otherwise, those pictures or video will be posted on the web. So somebody was victimized, and he or she was threatened. Now, but as an offense, now I hope this bill will target such activity. Now, on what is the difference between the voyeurism is for sexual gratification, but then for prying, it is for financial gain. Now, why do you have to separate the two? Now, on a non-consensual photography of intimate parts, now this involves exposing the genitals, the buttocks, and so on. Now, what is the purpose of separating the two offenses? And then also you say that it's going to be gender neutral. Now, for the breast, we have a different understanding of men's breasts and women's breasts. Men can expose the breast on the beach, for example. So it should not be the same as for women. Undersecretary, now can I just answer your second question on separating the legislation into two parts? Now, why do we separate the offense? First of all, because the first one has to do with sexual gratification, and we agree that this is more serious. And then the second one is more general, may not have the issue of sexual gratification, maybe it's for financial gain and so on. Now, why do we separate it? And if you don't separate it, what is going to be the result? There will be one serious and one light combined. And when it comes to court, the penalty should not be the same. And the judge has to exercise discretion. Now, it is easier if the two offenses are separate. So I defer to my colleague to answer the other questions. Now, on the male-female distinction, now the gender-neutral issue is one of the major principles of LRC. So in our process, we want to stick to this guideline. Now, if the context is the same for voyeurism, the victim, whether male or female, if the breast is shot or taken a picture of, it really should be an offense. And your first example, Yes, thank you for your observation. Yes, even the present legislation cannot really handle, and we will consider how to improve or make it more comprehensive. Mr. Charles Mok, and I will draw a line after Mr. Xiu Ka-chun. Now, thank you. Now, on voyeurism and related offences, now, if you look at the paper, and I really express a sigh on this issue. Now, on the obtaining access to a computer with a view to dishonest gain. Now, I've been pointing this out for a long time, but the government kept saying that this is not a problem. But finally, the CFA ruled that using his own computer can actually bypass the legislation. In early 2019, we talked about this legislation, and then there's also a related bill. But then the extradition bill stopped everything and changed the whole of Hong Kong. So I can only give a sigh. And now we have this paper in front of us. They are very traditional paper on consultation. You have 13 questions, and then members of the public can fill in their comments within the 3-month consultation period. And I thought about the Nationality Act released yesterday. The details were given. There was no details given, no consultation on the Nationality Safety Act, National Safety Act. Now, maybe you just follow your yesterday's approach and just do it very quickly, because it's not controversial at all.
But that cannot change reality. So coming back to the bill, you will be conducting public consultation, you will meet with different stakeholders. So I want to ask women's groups, NGOs, do you have plans to really consult them and garner their feedback? Thank you, Chairman. Regarding consultation, we will write them letters, and I'll have Mr. Wu elaborate later. Regarding statistics, voyeurism is quite prevalent in Hong Kong in the last 5 years, and on average we have 300 cases per year. So there is a need to introduce this legislation. Thank you, Chairman. As the Undersecretary said, we will notify groups that are affected. Well, please don't just write letters. You need to meet with them. You need to hear their victim stories. You need to be proactive. Mr. Xiu Ka-chun, thank you, Chairman. Introducing voyeurism and photography of intimate parts, we'll need to educate ourselves regarding these terms, I understand. We need to be accurate in our description. But on the other hand, when it becomes clinical, too clinical, we lose the human touch. When I heard Chairman read this item, I had that impression. Just now, Mr. Mok referred to women's groups. So the Undersecretary, in March this year, there was a survey regarding pornographic violence, and there were 11 victims who conducted interviews. There were some 200 cases of sharing experience. So I hope the government can contact them. If you haven't received the information, you should go and investigate. It is a concern group regarding sexual violence. So victims, when they call the police cannot build a case, and the victims suffer further hurt. So there has been no legislation regarding the dissemination of the non-consensual photography products. And a lot of social workers say that when they report cases of sexual violence, the whole process is very negative. They question the victim, whether they were making up their stories, whether they were trying to cover up a commercial sex activity. So while we do legislation work, the law enforcement agencies also need to enhance their sensitivity when they deal with non-consensual acts. Regarding the concern group for sex violence, we will take note of that. Thank you for the reminder. Regarding the dissemination of photography of intimate parts, that might come under blackmail or criminal intimidation. So when we do consultation, or when we come back to the panel, we will include this in our analysis. So after we have legislation, we will train our law enforcement officers, law enforcement officers or police. They need to sympathize with victims. So thank you for the reminder that legal terms need to be more human. So we need to comply with the law and also make it more comprehensible. Okay, we've drawn the line. The next one is Claudia Mo. Now in Hong Kong, if you're a journalist, you will recall that 10 plus years ago, the government had suggested that non-consensual photography could be criminalized, especially in a public place. The journalists felt they had the right to photography in a public place, and ultimately nothing came about that, and it led to dishonest use of a computer and so on. And now we have an offense of voyeurism. It's a sexual offense. And then non-consensual photography of intimate parts. When we hear the term, the Chinese term of simat, we think of pantyhose, but you are trying to describe acts that have commercial elements. We don't need to discuss voyeurism, that is very obvious, but we still have entertainment news. Now, if reporters photograph a celebrity in a, let's say, remote beach, and they are sunbathing, you've taken their picture, and these pictures can fetch a huge sum. And of course, there are mosaic, it's covered in a mosaic. So does that cover celebrities in public places when they are giving speeches, if they expose themselves? But if you cover it with a mosaic, then is that acceptable? Let me hand it over to Mr. Wu. Thank you, Chairman. The direction we're taking, according to the LRC feedback, Ms. Claudia Mo raised two questions. One relates to photography. If it comes under voyeurism or intimate prying, then the act is an offense. Well, the examples I gave were in public places. The photography, well, first of all, set aside the mosaic element. If you look at overseas cases, it's not necessarily has to be in a public place or is accessible to the public to comply with the voyeurism, because if there are reasonable expectations where they can expect privacy, then it could lead to voyeurism. Let's say they think it's a remote beach, so we do have some overseas legislation examples for your reference. Now, regarding dissemination or journalistic work, do they have a reasonable defense? We don't have a fixed position, but if you look at Canada or other jurisdictions, our suggestion is that we should have some defenses, but how should it be drafted? We'll have to look into that. Next, Mr. Chan Zhanying, my first question is related to Mr. Tan Jichun's question, and there wasn't a clear response. Now, I note that the LRC mentions six principles, gender neutrality, and so on, but there's also a term that is very hard to clarify, where we have areas that are hard to cover. Now, if you're talking about females, that's very easy, but what about male? What do we mean by areas covered by underwear? So when the law is passed, the public might have difficulty comprehending that. So how do we avoid these unclear areas? If you look at the current wording, I think this is quite problematic. Just now, Ms. Claudia Mo also asked about defenses. The direction we're talking is that if there are public interests, and they gave you two examples, one is law enforcement and journalists. So if a journalist, for example, there's no age or institution, we also have very young reporters working for the internet. So if a person gets a license and conducts these kinds of activities, so are they exempt? So how do we strike a balance? Thank you. We're now in a preliminary drafting process, so we would like to share our views with you, and we value your feedback. We will take your feedback, we will compile it, and when we do consultation, we will also analyze public views and come back to this panel. So in our preliminary view, we are trying to adopt the LRC principles, that is gender neutrality, and also the principle of protecting the victim. It doesn't mean that we don't need to protect males, so we have to strike a balance. We are not just considering males, well, we have to consider people who have undergone sex change operations. So they might feel oppressed, they might feel uncomfortable under certain circumstances. So the different stakeholders can provide their feedback during consultation. So a male or person of a different gender, we want to hear their views on regarding underwear. Now, the question regarding journalists, we respect freedom of press. Regarding voyeurism or other offenses, we still need to strike a balance. So freedom of the press, freedom, we still need to protect human rights, and as Mr. Wu said, in our future legislation, we will provide defenses, a reasonable defense. Or in overseas jurisdictions, they have public interest defenses, so we will consider all of that. So after Mr. Xiu Gachun's question, I drew the line. And Ms. Helena Wong, Claudia Mo, and Charles Mock want to ask a second round. So perhaps you'll have to ask in a different venue. I have called for legislation criminalizing voyeurism and photography of intimate parts, so I welcome the government's proposal. These should be sexual offenses, but I do have some questions. First of all, in paragraph 13, you say you've referred to overseas jurisdictions. So if there is an intention to make the victim humiliated and so on, that is an offense. But I find that to be problematic because some photographers, they might just want to boast or show off, or they might have a commercial interest, or they want to blackmail. It is not necessarily an intention to humiliate. That is not their consideration. They want to show off, or want to share, or intimidate, or sell the photographs. So if it's only an offense when there's the element of humiliation, then perhaps we'll have we won't have successful convictions.
Second question on down blousing or taking pictures of intimate parts. Now your point 15 is clear that if it's non-consensual, intimate parts include the breasts, but in paragraph 16 you mention they should not cover down blousing. So this is a bit contradictory. Well, you are not really trying to take shooting the collar or the neck part, but you rather want to take a picture of the breast with or without the cover of underwear. Now for victims, particularly women, especially if you take the breast including the nipples, and then if you show that on the web, this is a damage bigger than upskirt pictures. So I don't really agree with your point about paragraph 16 or stronger calls for criminalizing upskirt photography. Now, we have seen some really nasty pictures when a woman bends down and then you take picture of the breast because with a telephoto lens, and even the face is revealed. So this is a very big damage. Now, if this is taking picture of intimate parts already include this, there is no need for paragraph 16 because this is potentially misleading. Please be brief in your response. Now, the aim is of course to protect the victim when it comes to raising evidence, it may not have to have any distress caused as long as the criminal intent is established. That will do. Of course, we will absorb your view in the consultation and then report back to members. Dr. Fernando Zheng, now this voyeurism has been discussed a long time. Now in 2006, the ARC already established a working group, so it's taken them a long time. Now in 2019, the ARC also produced a report, and now we have another round of consultation. I think this is taking too long, but of course you have a detailed consideration, and yes, when you legislate, you need to have this processes. So we find it regrettable that the National Security Bill, such a big bill, is passed without consultation, not transparent at all, and not respecting the people of Hong Kong. So it was gazetted and then implemented right away, and everything was done in the dark. Now on this issue here, now I look at the aim you have, okay, voyeurism with the sexual gratification, and then number two, irrespective of the purpose of the conduct, or taking pictures of the breast, including breast of men, with or without cover of underwear. Now, but for men, if you take pictures of those of men bearing their breasts on the beach, it's not unusual at all. And if you distribute this without his consent, because you don't even know that person, will you commit an offense? Now, of course, you have a defense, but will the defense keep you safe? So I think we have to be very careful here, because otherwise we will inadvertently commit an offense. And as Mr. Siu Ka-jun said, on the report on sexual violence, they interviewed more than 200 people, and most who have been taken upskirt pictures did not know how to react at the time. And very few would go to the police. Some will, but after reporting to the police, their experience is that the police will refuse to take it any further. So usually, the police will say there's a lack of evidence and that it's not serious. Now, I want to ask the police, with the passing of this bill, will the police provide further training so that this sort of rejected reports will be removed? Thank you, Dr. Zheng. Okay, gender neutral is one of the LRC principles. Now, our thinking is to follow this principle. Now, if after consultation this is not necessary, we are entirely open. Now, on the other hand, in the past 5 years, every year we have about 300 such cases reported to the police. And now, without the offense on voyeurism and so on, we may not be able to press charges. So it's important to have these bills. Now, on the report and so on that you mentioned, yeah, we will look at them in detail. And after passage of the bill, we will provide more training to policemen on duty to be empathetic to the victims and to follow this up. Mr. LAM Cheuk-ting, we see a lot of secret photo taking, causing damage to victims. So if we have a bill to penalize these offenders, we agree. Now, but then the details are important. We do not want to see any gray areas, or that some people would inadvertently fell foul of the law. Now, as said earlier by a member, the media friends are very concerned. If, let's say, if you're doing the entertainment section of the media and their work is to be shooting pictures of movie stars, some in public places, taking their pictures or their different movements, or sometimes when they inadvertently expose certain underwear. Now, is it the case that these pictures cannot be taken anymore? Can you elaborate so that our press friends would know what you are thinking, and then they can give their comments and suggestions? Undersecretary, now, the law is clear, and we have to elaborate, as you rightly pointed out. Now, for voyeurism, one important vocabulary is that the victim or the potential victim is or expects to provide such pictures. Now, let's say in a public action, the movie star expects to have their picture taken. Okay? Now, so if, as you say, if you go to the premiere showing of movie, and if certain picture of their underwear being taken, and he or she is not protected, now, am I right? Now, if you look at the voyeurism issue, as well as the taking of intimate parts, these two offenses do not involve any reasonable expectation element. Now, I defer to Mr. Wu. Now, on the expected or reasonable expectation, now, in those situations that you described, it would not constitute an offense. But in other cases, if people taking upskirt pictures, we want to find the offender because this is non-consensual. Now, if you use a gadget underneath somebody's skirt and take a picture of the intimate part, and the intimate part in that situation would not be exposed, then it would be an offense. Of course, if somebody lifts up her skirt for everyone to see, and then if a reporter just take a picture of that, it would not be covered under this offense. Chair, I'm sorry. Now, can you please be clear? Now, if that's the case, if the reporter used a telegraphic or a telephoto lens with flashlight, then he will be committing offense. Now, let me just repeat, Chair. Now, without consent, and then if you use a gadget underneath the skirt, what do you mean by underneath? What if somebody is sitting down? Is it sitting down or standing up? No, if you put the camera underneath the skirt and take a picture, but what if I'm sitting down? If I'm sitting down, the skirt it points up forward, not downwards. Okay, now, Mr. Lam, now we have heard your views, Mr. Lam. Now, you are providing many different scenarios. Now, this will all be taken into account in our public consultation, as well as listening from you here. So we will summarize your views. Now, you have given me scenarios. Maybe the public would give us even more scenarios. So we will report back to members, and we will give you more information so you can understand the expectations of the public and the potential victims' views and so on. So we'll try to strike a balance there. Now, this brings this meeting to an end, and we have no AOB items today. So the meeting is adjourned. Thank you.